Hello, I feel proud to present the work of my students as a capstone project. They have done this project. It's the study of urban heat island effect in Aurangabad, Phulambri Tehsil through remote sensing and GIS. Now, we are not talking about the Aurangabad district. We are talking about Aurangabad, Phulambri Tehsil. Now, why Aurangabad, Phulambri Tehsil? What has happened is in our data set, the data set that we downloaded for free, that has got 8 tehsils. However, as on date, currently there are 9 tehsils. So Aurangabad and Phulambri were together earlier. As on date, they are separate. But the data that we downloaded for free contains Aurangabad and Phulambri together. So Aurangabad, Phulambri tehsil. Through remote sensing and GIS, it was guided by Dr. Suddhasheel Ghosh, that happens to be me. So the contributors to this project are Ms. Harshada, Ms. Mansi, Ms. Vinaya, Ms. Nikita, and Ms. Neha, all girls. The project influencer and the idea generator is Professor Medha, who is from the Department of Architecture at JNEC, which is currently known as the MGM University. So our objectives of the project are to describe the cause and effect of the urban heat islands in Aurangabad, basically. We are going to develop an understanding of applicable remotely sensed data for understanding urban heat islands. And we are going to identify the reasons behind the urban heat islands of Aurangabad, Phulambri, Tehsil. So our outcomes, which are actually deliverables, will be identification of applicably remotely sensed images for understanding UHI, preparation of multi-temporal maps of Aurangabad, and then explore the reasons for UHI in the study area, and we will finally recommend measures for controlling the UHI effect. So several literature was studied. Now, since April 2004, the concept of climate change has been there. The concept of land use, land cover change has been there, and this has been continuously being studied by many researchers by using in China, in India, in other places, and as a result, we select, based on whatever literature that we have studied, we select the following. Number one, we've got data sets and software. So what data set we are going to use and what software we are going to use. So the data sets are from GADM, the administrative boundary, that the same administrative boundary that we were talking about. It is an old block level boundary. It contains Aurangabad and Phulambri together. But the remote sensing data will be procured through Earth Explorer. See, a lot of remote sensing data is available, which contain thermal band information. Landsat data also contains thermal band. Only the thermal band can talk about the landscape temperature. So that's the reason why we have taken Landsat. The quantum GIS 3.4 here. Currently 3.10 is available, 3.12 is available, but at that point of the time, 3.4.4, that was being done. And inside quantum GIS, there is a semi-automatic classification plugin which can do basic image processing, basic top of the atmosphere correction. And using that basic plugin, we can calculate what we call as the thermal image of the area. So what we are trying to do is understanding the electromagnetic spectrum. Inside the electromagnetic spectrum, the infrared and visible wavelengths are present, and the infrared and visible wavelengths are basically the components which are there in the Landsat data. So the applicable remote sensing satellites or sensors, please remember that we have these are available ones. So we have Sentinel data, we have IRS ResourceSat data, we have got Landsat 7, Landsat 8 data available, but what is there is Sentinel data temperature product is available, but the satellite has been launched recently, so we cannot do multi-temporal. The resource sat data, which is from IRS, does not contain a thermal sensor. Landsat 7 has some problem with the striping. Landsat 9 is there, but then it has been launched recently, and therefore, since it is recent, we cannot do multi-temporal. Landsat 8 has been there since long. It contains both optical and thermal imaging sensors, and literature is also available. And therefore, I believe that this is the most suited study for urban heat islands. So what we are trying to do is, let us try to see that Landsat 8 contains two kinds of sensors. Number one, the observational land imager, that's called the OLI. So it has got band 1, band 2, band 3 up to band 9. And it has got what you call the thermal infrared sensor, the TIRS. The OLI and TIRS are basically two kinds of bands which are available. So the thermal imaging sensors, data from the thermal imaging sensors and data from the OLI, both are used in this study. So the electromagnetic spectrum, so you can see in this diagram, which has been taken from panchroma.com. In this diagram, it represents the Landsat 8 channels. So it says what is OLI and what is TIRS. So now we are going to select multiple times. So we are going to select from 2013 to 2018. How many dates are there? There are 6 dates. So now you can see that we are choosing most of the time, 23rd December, in 2013, 23rd December, 2014, 23rd December, 2016, 2015, 23rd December, and 2018 is 23rd December. But in this 2017, we have chosen the month of January. Why? Because it was known that in 2017, December, it was a rainy season. In the winter it rained. So therefore, the data which is available, it's very cloudy. It does not give us landscape information. And therefore, we cannot use that. Why we have chosen December? This number one, the sky is clear in December. And the chilly weather is going to give us the clear temperature difference between the hot spots and the nearby areas. So basically, winter data has been selected. It may not be the best logic that we can use, but this is the logic that we have used in this study. Okay. Now, we have taken data from timeanddate.com, which gives us that the minimum temperature, the atmospheric minimum temperature. Atmospheric minimum temperature is 1327. And this data is historically available. So using this data set itself, we can find out what are the specific minimum and maximum temperatures which are available on date on that particular, which were there on that particular dates on which the satellite data was downloaded, was captured. First of all, whenever we use any satellite data, we do dark object subtraction. So what is dark object? Basically, the atmosphere creates disturbances in the capture of the satellite data. So the atmospheric disturbances are added to the data. So what we have to do, the atmospheric distances are known as dark objects, and we have to subtract these dark objects from the from the satellite images. And for Landsat 8, the dark object subtraction algorithm is performed directly by semi-automatic classification plugin. If we want to really go through the formulae of the dark object subtraction, it is given in the Landsat 8 user's manual. we also compute the normalized difference vegetation index. Now, why do we calculate the normalized difference vegetation index? It's a conjecture. It's a conjecture. Now, people believe that the presence of vegetation is going to, reduce the temperature of the surrounding area, and therefore we do calculate the presence of vegetation. So the higher positive values in an NDVI, the normalized difference vegetation index, it's a well-known indicator for vegetation, and its value varies from minus 1 to plus 1, and higher positive values indicate healthy and dense vegetation. In addition, we are going to do some pan sharpening. Why are we going to do pan sharpening? So that my spatial details are, is clearly available. So usually what happens is, in a satellite data set, pan band is available, the panchromatic band is available, which has got, more spatial resolution. And in the satellite image, the normal red, green, blue bands are also available, which has got lesser spatial resolution. So what we want to do is more spatial resolution and more spectral resolution together, and that will give us an idea what kind of landscape it is, and also it will give an idea regarding the spatial features. We are specially focusing on the urban areas, and therefore we are going to do some pan sharpening. The pan sharpening is going to be used for certain purposes, which we'll explain later. The semi-automatic classification plugin also calculates what we call as the brightness temperature. So the thermal band is required, and the thermal band is in the TIRs band. We have shown you that list of bands earlier. And the land surface temperature is also calculated. And this paper, Avdan and Janowska, so it has got, it has proposed the following steps. So you first of all calculate NDVI from the bands. You then calculate emissivity from the bands. And then using this emissivity, calculate the land surface temperature. So this particular procedure has been recommended and reported in the Avdan and Janowska paper in 2016. So the name of the paper is Algorithm for Automated Mapping of Land Surface Temperature Using Landsat 8 Satellite Data. So it's from the Journal of Sensors. So the in data processing, so what we do is each data set is processed using the semi-automatic classification plugin. We call it the SCP here. We prepare pan sharpened data sets, and we compute the brightness temperatures. And finally, using these, these preparations, that computations, whatever we get, pan sharpened data set, pan sharpened band set, we have computed brightness temperature. We finally compute NDVI. And then the land surface temperature. And we also do, using GIS, some land use land cover preparation for all the years. So as a result, we have to, whenever we are talking about land use land cover preparation, we have to use some visualization and interpretation. The visualization is like this. So what we do is we map the bands available in our data to some color channels. Now, whenever we are visualizing any data, whenever we are seeing anything on the screen presents to the user the red, green, and blue channels. So what we have got the facility is we can map what we send to the red channel, what we send to the green channel, and what we send to the blue channel. So according to this, we do a mapping of band to the color channels, and we obtain what we call as a false color composite. What will happen with the false color composite? All the trees will appear red in color. All vegetation will basically appear red in color. The urban area will appear cyan in color. The open areas will appear some brown in color. So as a result, this thing is there. This is our flow chart. So based on whatever methods that we have studied in our literature, this is our flow chart. So what we do a tearsil boundary map. And we prepare a 500 meter grid map. Then we do some geoprocessing intersection and that. And using intersection and using whatever processes that we have described earlier, we are able to identify our urban hotspots. So this is our basic flow chart. So we do atmospheric correction using pan sharpening, and then we use pan sharpening. And then also simultaneously we calculate the NDVI, the brightness temperature and the land surface temperature using the NDVI. So, and then let us see what results are we doing. So, as a result, what we have done is these are pan sharpened false color composite maps of Aurangabad. So, we can see from these maps that in 2013 the maps appear more red, and in 2018 the reddishness has already gone. So, it means that there is a loss of the vegetated surface, there is a loss of the surface which was covered with trees. So it's a warning signal. It might be also a warning signal that the land surface temperature will also increase. The pan sharpened false color composite maps of Aurangabad. So these are the representations here. So also we computed the normalized difference vegetation index maps of Aurangabad. So you can see the 2013 images are more brighter in color. And 2018 images are more darker in color, thus implying that 2018 images have less amount of vegetation, 2013 images have more amount of vegetation. Directly implication is like that. And as a result, we are able to compute the brightness temperature maps of Aurangabad, and this is directly possible through your SCP. These maps are computed, and we can see there will be certain areas which contain, like 5 to 10 and 10 to 15, 15 to 20, 25 to 30, and we have been able to compute the brightness temperatures of all these areas. And you can see the map of 2015 appears more red compared to other times. Why? This is typically happening because in 2015 there was a temperature rise, the local temperature rise, and as a result we are seeing that in 2050 the map is appearing more red in color. Similarly, 2018 also it is red, but it is a bit less red. So we can see in 2015 here the maximum temperature is 41.12. it is seen here from the brightness temperature itself. So again, now using your algorithm by Avdan and Yavnoska, that is 2016, and we have been able to compute the land surface temperature maps of Aurangabad. You can see very clearly that in 2015 the map is appearing more red in color, in 2013 map is appearing more blue in color, and you can see 2018 is a bit less red, but still it is red. Again, you can see that land surface temperature ranges are from 17.2183 to 42.4675. And remember that 42.4675 is in the month of December. Alright, so this is derived from the map which is being procured in the winter season, but the temperature is 42.4675. So which means that it is possible that the temperature of the land surface is higher than the temperature of the day, which is possible. And this is these represent the land use, land cover maps of Aurangabad. Why do I do that? I have just classified here, my students have classified here urban areas, vegetation, water body, agriculture and barren land. And this is done by hand, this is not an automated one. But this has been done by hand. So all the you can see that agricultural areas are continuously increasing. You can see this in these statistics. So there is a gradual increase, of course, in the urban area, obviously, and water bodies seem to be decreasing in size. It's clearly available through this LULC statistics. So probably there is a heat island map. These are heat islands basically. So what are heat islands that I say as my study? Any area which has got higher temperature, land surface temperature higher than the daily temperature, the atmospheric temperature, that will be a probable heat island map of Aurangabad. So this is what it is happening here right now. So and then UHI and heat island and non-heat island statistics are presented here, and we can see that the quantity of heat islands is continuously increasing. And now what we have to do is we have to find out where these heat islands happen. So what we do is we do some raster processing. We do some binary raster processing, and these are binary maps. The last slide, the last to last slide, what we are doing is these are binary maps. So either the values are true or false, or 0 and 1. If the temperature is higher than the daily temperature, then it is marked as white. If the temperature is lower than the daily temperature, it is marked as black. So here it is true or false. So as a result, we are able to do a combined raster map. So what I do is this raster and that raster and that raster and that raster. So continuously, if any pixel has white values for all the 6 years, that is a potential heat island. Now, out of these heat islands may be open areas. They might be rocky areas. There are a lot of rocky areas in Aurangabad. But I am interested in urban heat islands. I am interested in the urban areas only. So what I do is I use the urban area map to urban area map. So this is my urban area, okay, and that red colored area which is mapped here, it is the urban area. And what we are going to do is I am going to overlay this map with the yes or no map, this one with this one, and as a result I am going to combine this, and we identify therefore four areas which are remarkably hot areas compared to the neighboring surroundings. So this is the airport. Wadus is one place where the industrial township is coming up. There is Satala Devlai and there is Naregaon. Naregaon is a disputed area in Aurangabad. One can look up the internet. We'll show you the pictures of these areas. So this is Naregaon. Naregaon is a dumping ground, and many people are burning their garbage there. You can see there is no systematic residential area, and there is no proper planning in this area also. This is Naregaon. The picture represents Naregaon. So, and the drainage system here is not appropriate. The barren lands are there, and the burning of garbage also goes on here. This is the airport. Obviously, airport has an open runway strip is there. And you see a lot of areas are under the construction in the airport. And as a result, the loss of vegetation is obviously observed. So vegetation is definitely drying there. This is Wadus. So Wadus in an industrial area. So there are indeed certain areas which have got trees, but still the urbanization is also there. This is Satara Devlai. Now Satara Devlai is very strange because it has happened in Satara Devlai that the urbanization has happened on an agricultural area. So, and you can see that there are no tree canopies in this area also. So barren land, agricultural land converting into residential area, which is very dangerous. There is unplanned urbanization, which is again very dangerous. And mountains and rocks are there, which has of course base on. So we propose the following standard measures. These measures are there: light colored concrete and white roofs. We are proposing green roofs. Green parking lots can be made here. The urban relief can be made by planting trees in the cities. Rainwater harvesting for cooling. And awareness of implementation of heat reduction policies and regulations. So the regulations have to be proposed here. The contributions of this work are to use multi-temporal remote sensing data for understanding heat islands. We identified heat islands using programming logic and image processing, and we have conducted certain site visits to verify the reductions obtained using the work obtained. So we have conducted, unlike the other way around, usually when we process remote sensing data, people go to the site and then they do the survey. So what we have done is we went to the site after what we have concluded. We have used an algorithm, and after we wanted to compare the success of the algorithm, and that's the reason why we have done site visits afterwards. So as a conclusion, what we can say, the remote sensing data were used to understand the landscape without a visit to the field. The existence of past data sets enable us to understand the past incidents and situations of the landscape. Hot and not so hot areas were identified using remote sensing data. Multi-temporal remote sensing data enables better understanding of heat islands, and remedial measures were proposed for the identification of hotspot areas. So thank you very much for listening.